But I don't, again, I don't wanna leave you thinking of no hope, you just throw up your hands in despair and move on to some other topic. There are some conservation success stories, there are examples where people with governments cooperating, working together, and really save things from the brink of extinction in ways that are inspiring and can give us an idea of what kinds of practices are possible in order to, if not completely stop this from happening, at least reverse the trend and save some of the biodiversity. So there are positive action steps. I think it's always good to think about actual definitive, concrete, specific things that can be done. One is to set realistic priorities. Not everything can be saved. And in some cases, the expense and logistics of saving certain things is probably unrealistic. But there are, and I'll get to what I mean by this in a moment, what are called biodiversity hotspots that provide means of saving a maximum number of species in a minimum geographic area. Using more sustainable resources is best practices for doing that would certainly be helpful. Providing economic incentives. Obviously, people are in some ways, in many ways, driven by their own survival, and it's hard to make the case, particularly in developing countries, that they need to save biodiversity at the expense of their own life and being able to feed their children and so on. And the old culprit, not again surprised to show up on a list like this, reducing the use of fossil fuels. So I'll go through a little bit more specifics on each of these and then talk about some conservation success stories. Anybody know what birds are flying? Curiosity. One of the iconic conservation success stories in recent years. Okay, well, we'll go. So hotspots. This map, the areas of the red are the so-called global biodiversity hotspots. And 45% of known plant species and 35% of vertebrate animals or bony skeleton species are found in 25 hotspots that total only 2% of the Earth's surface. So you do the math, it's actually pretty straightforward. If you focus a lot of effort, conservation efforts, protecting habitats and setting aside refugees in those 25 hotspots, you get, so to speak, a maximum conservation bang for the buck. So prioritizing protection efforts in hotspots would have the payoff of saving potentially a maximum number of species in areas that logistically are realistic to think about, as opposed to huge swaths of territory. And there is a lot of conservation effort that's focused on those hotspots. In the US, if you look at the map carefully, the leading biodiversity hotspots are actually in southern Florida and along the west coast and the southwest area of the country. And then globally around the world, I'm not gonna go through all of them, obviously, but each of the little the red areas you see on the map, again, has a relatively very high level of species richness in a relatively small geographic area. Okay, questions on that? Sustainable food, a big one, one that certainly affects all of us. Sustainable simply means that the food, whatever it is, it could be some kind of plant crop, it could be meat, fish, that it's harvested, it's developed and harvested in a way that doesn't do serious harm to the ecosystem. And it also allows the species to continue reproducing. So a really simple way of putting it. One example would be you don't catch all of the individuals of the species that eat it. Eat them. It just wouldn't make any sense at all, obviously. You do that because it would irreversibly harm that species' ability to survive. And you also have to ensure while you're doing this that whatever kind of food production operation is involved remains profitable to the farmer or rancher, people fishing, and so on. So sustainable has to be sustainable for the species that is being targeted, but it also has to be sustainable for the humans that are involved in producing that. Food. appears maybe top of the list as far as examples of something that's non-sustainable. Shark fin soup. Shark fin soup is a delicacy, a specialty food item that is literally, as the name says, made from shark fins. Shark fins have cartilage. That cartilage is used in making the soup. So they kill large numbers of sharks just for their fins. They don't use any of the rest of the shark. They cut the fins off and throw the sharks back into the ocean. They die a pretty miserable death. Sharks actually have typically very low rate of reproduction. They only give birth to a few so-called shark pups at a time, and it takes a while for those pups to develop. They're vulnerable species. Many shark species are quite vulnerable. So shark fin soup, I think, would be a textbook example of a non-sustainable food resource. And again, they don't even use the rest of the shark. They don't need meat or anything else from the shark. The opposite end of the extreme involves sustainable fisheries. So examples could include limiting the number of fish that are caught. You don't want to catch all the, close to all the individuals, and drive the numbers down so low that they can't recover. You can limit the size of fishes that can be taken, so you're not getting them when they're either too young and haven't had a chance to throw to the point where they can reproduce. You can limit the season at which you target some species, so you're not catching them during the time of year that they are reproducing. You don't want to select out all the individuals just as they're mating and laying eggs and spawning. You want to give them a chance to go through that part of their life cycle and produce the next generation. And another emphasis in some areas is on reducing what's called the bycatch. And that if you throw a fishing net into the ocean and you drag it through the seawater, you're going to come up with species in addition to the ones you're really trying to catch. And the ones that you're not trying to catch are called the bycatch. And in some cases, that could be other fish that you're not going to eat. It could be seabirds that get caught up in the nets, and so on. So there are a number of things that you can do that don't affect the ability to catch the target species, but that will reduce the amount of bycatch. And you can also look, if you like seafood, or there are a number of organizations that certify that fish or other seafood are caught using sustainable methods. This one is the Marine Stewardship Council. There are a number of them. You see little logos on packages of seafood. So it's not a bad idea to try to use those. Yeah?
I understand that those are good things, but how far do you really believe what they're using?
Yeah, the question is how far can you believe that? And that's not the question.
Well,
yeah, organic foods are another, in some ways, separate issue. One thing to be careful of, and this is in a later slide, but I'll mention it now, there's something called greenwashing. And greenwashing refers to trying to make it look like your product is ecologically sensitive and environmentally friendly and sustainable, but it may not actually be. So it's easy to slap a logo, any company can slap a logo on something and say, eco-friendly, or whatever term they want to use. You need to actually see whether they're in fact practicing things that make that claim true, or whether they're just doing it because it increases the price at which they're able to sell something, or it makes it more likely that people will buy it who have a concern about the environment. So yeah, there are definite issues. I'm giving you a pretty simple version, but you're right, you need to look at it sometimes in a more sophisticated way. And this is exactly what this next slide is, green certification. So just as an example, in Central America, there's a consortium of coffee plantations, and they have agreed to preserve the rainforest by growing shade-grown coffee. So they don't have to cut the trees down to grow the coffee. There are different kinds of coffee. Some of it grows better in open sunlight. You have to cut the trees down before you plant the coffee plants. Other types of coffee, you need to clear out some of the underbrush, but you can leave some of the larger trees and grow the coffee in shade. So shade-grown coffee obviously is a bit friendlier to the environment than coffee that has to involve clear-cutting the forest before you can So there are benefits. It benefits the environment, but you don't cut all the big trees down. So it saves in that sense. It also allows you, and this kind of relates, I think, to your question, it allows you to do things like put a little sticker on it that says Rainforest Alliance certified. So people going to high-end stores to buy expensive coffee might decide, I can buy the coffee that's helping save the rainforest because I think rainforests are cool and I want to help save them. But again, you have to be a little careful with that if you don't get basically swindled into thinking that something is eco-friendly when it's not. And again, that leads into this line, so greenwashing. And greenwashing refers to companies or products that promote themselves as eco-friendly but are actually not really green in a sense. They might claim that the product is sustainable when it's not. They might create their own certification or just calling something natural. I mean, I don't think that 7-Up is actually 100% natural and green friendly. I'm not trying to single out 7-Up in some unfair way, but it's soda. It's got like 14 teaspoons of sugar and 12-ounce can or something like that. So I'm not telling you don't drink 7-Up. If you want to drink 7-Up, but I doubt very much that 7-Up is helping to save the planet. And one issue is that you heard a lot of these green certification logos of different programs for trying to address this issue by saying that they're eco-friendly. And this is just one image that I listed off Google Image Search. All these logos and stickers and organizations and so on have something to do with asserting that their product or whatever it is they're trying to sell is either pure or natural or good for the environment or somehow eco-friendly. So it can be hard to tell which of these are legit and which of them might actually be bogus. A big one, actually, and when you get to the point where you're deciding on travel, this can be something to consider, is what is generally lumped under the term ecotourism. And the idea is that people visiting countries with interesting biodiversity, wildlife, and so on, the idea is that they do it in such a way that it economically benefits the people living there. So it creates a financial incentive for local communities to get involved in preserving biodiversity. This is just one example. This beautiful little bird is called Quetzal. It has actually long, streaming tail feathers that you can see in this picture. They live in kind of mid-elevation rainforest in Central America. And they love wild avocados. Wild avocados have a fruit on them that's much smaller than the avocados that you buy in the store. Farmers that are farming the slopes of the mountains where the quetzals live and where the wild avocados trees grow naturally have been incentivized to save the avocado trees that the quetzals love to feed on by just basically being paid by ecotourism lodges in the same area. So when you stay in a lodge up in the rainforest, like it's a very nice one in the picture on the lower right that I stayed in a couple of years ago, beautiful place. Some of what you pay to stay there actually goes from the lodge back to the farmers. And in return for that, the farmers agree to leave patches of the avocado trees intact and not farm those plots so that the quetzals have a place to go and feed. So it's a mutually beneficial little system that they set up. This is a nice example of how ecotourism can work. Farmers benefit, the lodges benefit, the tourists and bird watchers who want to go and see these wonderful animals have a chance to be able to see them in a nice environment. Obviously, there's cutting fossil fuel-based energy use, solar power, wind power, better cars. I think this is these are things that you probably have all heard about maybe in other classes. But using renewable resources has a beneficial impact on reducing the amount of greenhouse gases that are emitted, reducing the use of carbon-based fossil fuels. Even simple things. don't seem very dramatic, like using reusable cloth bags instead of plastic ones when you go shopping. This is the, think globally in the big picture, but do some very simple things at home locally that can actually have an impact. So, some conservation success stories. Again, I don't want to leave you with the impression that there's no hope and everything's grim and everything's going to be lost. There are some really interesting cases, I think, of where, again, individuals, conservation organizations, countries have worked together to preserve some really magnificent species. Gray whale. I grew up in San Diego at a time when gray whales were just starting to recover. And they are medium-sized whales that live in the Pacific. There used to be Atlantic gray whales, but they've been wiped out many years ago. And at one time, less than 100 years ago, the numbers were down to fewer than 1,000. And these are whales spread out over a huge ocean, so fewer than 1,000 is getting actually close to being at risk of extinction. They were under pressure during the days of commercial whaling, and also the areas they breed in the shallow lagoons along the coast of Baja California that weren't protected. The numbers now are up to a much healthier level, probably in the neighborhood of about 25,000. The lagoons are protected by the government of Mexico, and actually there's a thriving ecotourism business and people coming down to see the whales in those lagoons. They're no longer hunted except in very small numbers by Japan, which is controversial. The Japanese people still take a very small number of gray whales, some do. And they benefited, particularly in the U.S., by the passage of the Marine Mammal Protection Act in around 1970. So all marine mammals, whales, seals, dolphins, and so on, are legally protected in the U.S. waters. So they've recovered. They're at no immediate risk of extinction any longer. The deer, this is a small deer species that lives in southern Florida. They were really skirting at the edge of extinction. There were only 25 key deer around 1950 hunting. People like to hunt deer in Florida, just as they do in Michigan. And roadkills, they would come out onto the road. They're pretty small of the values for this kind of size. Be hit by cars. There was a really intensive effort to save them, including creating the National Key Deer Refuge in Florida, preserve remaining habitat, and the population is now getting close to 1,000 the last time that I looked up the numbers for key deer. And they've benefited from another piece of legislation in the U.S., the Endangered Species Act, which when species are declared to be at risk of extinction, steps have to be taken in the U.S. to preserve habitat and try to promote their survival. Familiar beast, the American alligator, once very heavily hunted. It was actually on the endangered species list in 1967. If you go down to Florida, Louisiana, this is along the Gulf Coast now, it's really easy to see alligators. So people don't realize just how vulnerable they were some years ago. They were hunted, and also even more seriously than that, serious factor in that habitat loss. So preserving their habitat and a ban on hunting for a period has helped them recover. Hunting alligators is no longer completely banned. And they recovered actually reasonably quickly. So they were put on the endangered species list in 1967, taken off in 1987. So they're a really dramatic success story. And Florida really wouldn't be Florida without alligators. So I think that's one of the really notable successes. Timber wolf or gray wolf. This was actually an issue now in Michigan as to whether or not we should be hunting wild on gray wolf. They're formerly very widespread. They occurred not only in North America, but across a big swath of Europe. See the statistics up on the screen. The last European wolves disappeared from England in 1400s, Scotland in the 1700s, and then also Ireland. The usual reasons that some of you may be aware of, they were killed because they were a threat to livestock. They're also in some areas thought to attack humans, although wolf attacks on humans are actually very, very rare. They've now been, and of course the usual habitat loss. So they've been reintroduced, and some places and some communities that reintroduction is controversial. There are farmers, livestock, people that have livestock that really aren't crazy about the idea of having wolves back in and around their farming and cattle operations. There are groups, including conservation groups, that compensate ranchers when they lose livestock and wolves, so that there's an economic payoff in the sense they're not suffering financially from it. They are very important for the ecological balance. If you start running out of wolves, the things that the wolves eat start overpopulating, so you end up with deer and moose and elk pairing in much larger numbers than they should. That in turn deteriorates the environment because they overgraze, eat a lot of the plants, and so on, and the environment starts to deteriorate. So wolves are really important maintainers of a proper ecological balance, as is the case with population predators in general. And again, there is that issue of whether hunting on wolves should be allowed by nature. It kind of goes back and forth in recent years. Our natural symbol, the bald eagle. You're all probably too young to remember this, but at one point there was real concern over whether bald eagles would at least disappear from the lower 48 states in the U.S. They were listed as endangered in the lower 48 in 1967. For some of those years, there were a number of pairs of bald eagles in lower 48 were up into the hundreds. There are now more than that just in Michigan, something like 700 plus pairs in Michigan in recent years. So the population really declined sharply. There were maybe 500,000 birds when the U.S. was founded. Big factor here again was DDT, the thinning of eggshells from this pesticide affecting their ability to lay healthy eggs. There are also people were shot by people. Species recovered, the really pace of its recovery picks up dramatically when DDT is banned in the U.S. in 1972. So we now have well over 100,000 bald eagles, and they were removed from the endangered species list, again in the lower 48 states in 2007. So they've recovered pretty well. This is the bird that I showed earlier when I asked if anybody knew what species of bird it was. This is the whooping crane, the tallest bird in North America. The adult whooping crane, standing on the floor, its head would be almost looking me in the eye. They stand up to about 5 feet tall. Spectacular, huge white birds with a little black along the edge of their wings. They spend the winters on coastal marshes in Texas and in some marshes inland in New Mexico. In 1940, there were 16 whooping cranes total, full stop, period, 16 left. That is, you know, if nothing was done, they would have been extinct long ago. 16 birds is not what we would call a sustainable number for any species of birds. What they've done is captive bred them. They brought them into captivity under controlled circumstances where they're not prone to predators or they're not going to get hit by cars or shot by people and so on. So most of the whooping cranes now were born in captivity, including this little guy strutting around at the whooping crane facility. Right now there are nearly 500 whooping cranes and more than half of them are in the wild. So there still is a captive population that, among other things, is really kind of an insurance policy. If something terrible happens in the wild, you'll at least have some of these cranes still in captivity. one of the things they're famous for is when they're raised in captivity, but the ambition is always to return them to the wild and let them live out their life in a more natural way. They have to be taught certain things that their parents would usually teach them, but if they're raised in captivity, they have humans that have helped raise them, not their natural parents. So one of the things they have to learn to do is to migrate. These whooping cranes migrate back and forth seasonally. They go up north during the summer, and then they go through these marshes along the Gulf of Mexico in the winter. So this is a flock of whooping cranes learning how to migrate by flying behind a small aircraft. And their birds are imprinted on the aircraft and on the person flying this little airplane. So they taught them the route, and they taught them how to migrate back and forth down to Florida, Texas, and really kind of an amazing effort, and still ongoing. They're not certainly out of the woods yet. 500 plus or minus whooping cranes is still not really a totally healthy number, but they don't appear to be at any immediate risk of extinction. This is the European lynx, beautiful spotted cat. Populations in Europe have now been increasing. They were thought to have been at risk of extinction. They've been helped by increasing their food supply. They promoted increasing numbers of wild deer in Europe. They are places like the mountains, more remote areas of Spain particularly. And they've done things like put up electric fences around livestock instead of farm animals to protect them, instead of actually just shooting lynxes to keep them from killing farm animals. Another birds really figure prominently. Birds have a big following, so they are classic, as I mentioned, charismatic. Reintroduced in 2014, just a year ago, into areas of the rainforest of Mexico where they had not lived since the mid-1960s. And they appear to be doing pretty well. As long as there's enough habitat and they're not harassed, they actually do pretty well there. So they're spreading back into part of what used to be their naturally occurring range in Mexico. And then I saved probably the most dramatic example for last. This is the California condor, basically a big vulture. The largest flying bird in North America, has a 9-foot wingspan, so 9 feet from wingtip to wingtip. They live in the Southwest, California, Arizona, mountains, high deserts, and also along coastal mountains. They were shot illegally. They also suffered from lead poisoning because they eat dead animals. They're scavengers like other vultures. So they eat dead animals that have been shot, and they have been shot using lead shot and shotguns. And the lead, levels of lead would accumulate in their body because they were eating dead animals that had lead from the lead shotgun pellets. And the lead would get to the point. The concentrations in the condors were unstable. So that was good. The most dramatic step that's ever been taken to save the species was applied to the involving the condor. In 1987, there were 22 remaining birds that were alive. They were all captured and put into a captive breeding facility. So at that point, there were no California condors anywhere in the wild. The only remaining birds, these 22 birds, were just living in captivity. And they would breed them in captivity, and what they would do is when a female laid eggs, they would remove that clutch of eggs, and the female bird would sometimes lay another clutch. And so they would do what's literally called double clutching, or multiple clutches of eggs. Remove the first clutch and raise them in incubators, and then allow the female to lay another clutch of hopefully healthy eggs. So they started reintroducing condors into the wild within a few years. Actually, the captive breeding is very successful. Now there are about 350 of these birds. About 150 of them are in the wild. There is a small wild here's one of the techniques they used. They didn't want the birds to imprint on humans. So if you had walked up to one of these condor chicks and it had seen you, it would have bonded with you, because their instinct is to bond and imprint on for the first thing they see when they come out of the egg. So to keep that from happening, to keep them as, in effect, wild as they could, and only familiar with and used to being around other condors, they did things like use very realistic hand puppets to feed them. So that's a condor chick born in captivity, and that's not a real condor on the right. That's somebody with a hand puppet in the shape of a condor head feeding it little bits of meat so that it would not imprint on humans. And you don't want them imprinting on humans. You don't want to release your condors in the wild and have them start following people around. It's dangerous for the condors and possibly kind of alarming to people to have a 9-foot wingspan bird suddenly following you. Not good news. They're not dangerous to people, but still, it could be kind of alarming. It's just not something you want to happen. Imagine you step out in the street in California and a 9-foot wingspan bird suddenly starts hopping along and following you. It might get you. And so this is that, I think a fitting way to end this lecture. One of the captive bred and now wild complete condors have been four points today. Not quite enough. I like this. I also like this word from Darwin. So I talked about Darwin. The last sentence of Darwin's book on the origin of species is the quote that you see up here. I'll let you read it. I'm not going to read that. So then I have one or two things to say about the exam. Probably the most famous quote in biology, I would say, without going on. So, in terms of what we're next, the exam is next Tuesday. Our exam is next Tuesday in this room. Exam 3 is 12:45. Be the same format, multiple choice, few true false, same point value, 100 as exams 1 and 2. Remember, I still get this question a bit, it only covers the lecture topics since the second exam. And this Thursday,